Just have the title because I've not titled it. Amen. That's how unprepared I am. Amen. It says, what or who do you rely on? Sister Buki, I like it when you are in church. Who do you rely on? What do you rely on? Okay, I didn't ask for an answer. Thank you. God bless you. Hallelujah. I said I would be a bit informal today. So just pardon me, because we are brothers and sisters. Amen. We are no special people. Amen. So it doesn't always have to be very formal. Amen. The question is, what or who do you rely on? I will use the what most of the time. What do you rely on? Every growing and maturing Christian comes to a point that he wishes and he wants to hear God speak. Many of us here have asked ourselves that question before, that when is God going to speak to me? When Elder Chris stands here, he said, and God said. When Elder stands here, he said, and God said. When Prophet came, he said, God spoke to me. So have you asked yourself that question before, that God, when are you going to speak to me? When am I going to hear your voice? Everybody is hearing your voice and they're talking about it. When am I going to hear your voice? When am I going to hear your voice? When will you speak to me, oh God? I also want to hear your voice. Especially when you find yourself in a difficult situation, in a difficult position, and you go on your knees to pray, and you have been praying, speaking to God, weeping and everything, and still no answer seems to be coming. You ask yourself, God, are you there? God, did you hear what I said in prayer? God, have you spoken? Can you speak to me? Can I hear your voice? Let me know your decision. Let me know your mind concerning this situation. What shall I do? When you come to a difficult place, a difficult position, you need the voice of God. This is where most of us, we rely on people ahead of us, our parents. We rely on people who we think they know. So you may call elder, you may call pastor, you may call prophet, you may call anybody you think may have answer to your problem, because you are looking for an answer. You are looking for God to speak, if not to you direct. You are expecting that God will speak through somebody, you know, to give you the answer of your problem. Amen. So every Christian, at a point in time, you want, when you are growing and mature, you want to hear the voice of God. So when I have stood here and said, God said this, at least you should also hear it. Amen. Have you come to that point before? Have you asked yourself that question before? I remember some months ago, my wife asked me the same question. I woke up one morning, I said, why is your face like this? I don't know. Can God really speak? I said, yes, God can speak. If you want God to speak to you, God will speak to you. Hallelujah. I don't know what you find yourself in. I don't know what questions are in your heart. But I want to tell you this morning that God really speaks.
Amen.
And through this preaching, I believe that the solution will come up.
Amen.
that the door will open for you to have the means and how God can speak to you. Hallelujah. But for church, for us also to be aware that God is also willing and He wishes that all His children, regardless of our level, regardless of your level, God is wishing and willing that He will speak. All His children will be able to hear His voice. Will be able to have communication with Him as a father. Amen. God is willing to do that. So when Jesus was teaching in John 10, He said about the good shepherd, He said, "My sheep knows my voice, and I know them when they cry." We have many children here, but let us go out there behind the door and start crying. I can identify the voice of Esme among the 10 children there who are maybe screaming and shouting because she's mine. Hallelujah. God knows you. So whenever you cry, God hears. But God is looking and looking for our attention, looking for us also to be able to come to the place where we can identify and hear His voice also. Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 Let's open our Bibles to Exodus. Let's do some reading. Exodus chapter 3, verse 5. And Kobe, can I have it on the screen, please? And then Joshua chapter 5, verse 15. Have that at the background. Exodus chapter 3, verse 5. It says, "And he said, draw not nigh hither, but put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy ground." Hallelujah.
Amen.
Say holy ground.
Holy ground.
This is between God and Moses. And we all know the story of Moses. How he was given birth to, how he was placed on the river, and the daughter of Pharaoh got him, and he ended up in the palace, and everything. You know all the story. But let me begin from when Moses was growing up. Moses originally is not an Egyptian. He's a Hebrew. He's an Israelite. And Moses became a commander in the army of the Egyptians who were oppressing the Israelites. But one day, one of the elders of the Hebrews called him to a corner and gave him an information. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Yes.
And he made Moses aware that, look, though you are coming from the palace, but you are truly not an Egyptian. Tell somebody, you are not an Egyptian.
You are not an Egyptian.
You are not an Egyptian.
Not an Egyptian.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
It takes somebody to give certain information before you can see the light.
Amen.
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 As soon as this information got to Moses, the spirit in Moses were rekindled, and his passion was increased for the slaves. Already he had a passion for the slaves. He didn't understand it. But when this information got to him that, "Moses, you are not a true Egyptian. You are an Israelite. You are a Hebrew. These people you are oppressing, they are yours, they are your blood." Moses changed his character and he began to have extra passion and compassion for the slaves, for the Israelites. So one day, he met one of the Egyptian soldiers caning and beating one Israelite. And this passion rose up in Moses. So Moses killed the soldier. The news got to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh wasn't happy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm saying all this long story because I want to come to a very brief point and we finish. Amen.
Amen.
The news got to Pharaoh. So Moses had to run away. He ran away to a far place. The Bible says he went to a desert, and he came to a town where he met two ladies fetching water, trying to feed their flock. So he offered to help them so that he can also get water for his camel. Please watch this. Everything that has happened here this morning is part of the message you have to hear today.
Amen.
Amen. Moses, who was a prince in the palace of Pharaoh, have now become a fugitive, a runaway guy, and he has left the palace. The Bible says he refused to be called the son of the queen, the son of the king of Egypt. He refused that title, and he became a fugitive. He ran away, and he has become a servant. When God wants your attention, he's going to cut certain things around you in order for him to speak to you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
As if that was enough, these ladies took him home to Jethro, who was a minister of God's too. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And Jethro offered his daughter for Moses to marry. So Moses became part of them, and he started looking after the flock of Jethro. One day the Bible says he took the flock to the desert as usual to feed them. And this time he went beyond the desert on a mountain called Horeb. That place, Horeb, is the mountain of God. Amen.
Amen.
Horeb is the mountain of God. It's the same name, it's the same place, it's called Mount Sinai. Amen?
Amen.
That's a place of God. God chose that place. That was where God called Moses later on to give him the commandment, Mount Sinai. That was where God arranged a meeting between himself and the Israelites. Hallelujah. And the Israelites couldn't go. They said, Moses, you go and speak to God. We are scared. We can't go. So Moses didn't know all this, but he went beyond the desert, went onto the Mount Horeb. And as soon as he got there, he saw a sign. He saw a wonder.
Amen.
He saw that flame in the bush. He saw that fire in the bush, which was not burning. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Many of us sitting here today who have become Christian, many of us who are listening today who have become Christian and even have had the opportunity to stand here and or stand somewhere and speak the gospel to somebody, we were brought in through a miracle. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God used that miracle to catch the attention of Moses that you have come where I want you to be. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Many of us have become Christians, have become born again through one miracle or the other. But that is not the end of it. That is not the end of it. Hallelujah. Beyond the miracle, beyond your healing, which made you a Christian, which brought you into the kingdom of God, God has a purpose for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So Moses saw this fire and he said, I will go near it and investigate because this is a wonder. God will always use something to catch your attention.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
This time the Israelites have been going through troubles and, you know, have been going through suffering. Slavery is not an easy thing. They were being tormented. When you watch that the video, at a point I was crying. I said, my God, the person have not eaten. You have not given them any good food to eat. They farm for you and they farm for themselves. And you ask them to build the city. So they're building huge buildings and they are working hard. And upon the working hard, they are being beaten as well. It was not an easy thing. When you go to chapter 2, you see that they were crying. At a point, they cried unto God. When they have finished what they have to do, when their masters have released them and they come together, they pray and cry to God. And the Bible said God heard their cry. But then God was preparing Moses. God was preparing Moses. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's not where I want to go, so I'll quickly go on. Amen. So Moses wanted to investigate the fire, and God said to him, Moses, remove your sandals, for where you stand is a holy ground. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Do you have Joshua there? Joshua chapter 5. Verse 15 says, the commander of the Lord's army said to Joshua, Take your sandals off your foot, for the place where you stand is a holy ground. This is Joshua also, who have come face to face with the walls of Jericho. Another stumbling block. Another reason for you not to progress. Another devil to withstand you. Joshua was confused. He has exhausted all his plans and all his tactics. He didn't know what to do. When you read the story from verse 1, you realize that Joshua was just walking about, confused, didn't know what to do, what plan to take. He lifted up his eye and he saw a man standing with a sword in his hand. And he said to him, "Are you with us or you are against us?" I can sense that Joshua was then so angry. So if this guy had said, "I'm against you," he would have dealt with him straight away. Amen.
Amen.
But he said, "I'm not against you, but I'm an angel of God. I am a commander of the army of God, and I have come to help you." Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 Sometimes when the help of God is coming to you, it looks as if it's an enemy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God will send a help no matter the situation. No matter how confused you are, one day God will send a help.
Amen.
But God must speak to you. God must speak to me. Amen.
Amen.
This is what the angel said to Joshua. He said, "Remove your sandals, for where you are standing is a holy ground." The quick lesson I grab from this is that wherever God is present, it doesn't matter the area, the place becomes holy ground.
Yes.
Straight away.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And one has to acknowledge it.
Yes.
It doesn't matter, it's your home, it's your office, it's your workplace, it's a church room. When you sense the presence of God, the place becomes a holy ground.
Yes.
Automatically.
Holy.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He is holy.
Amen.
That's what I'm saying. Everything you have heard this morning, God meant it for you to hear it. So my preaching is not much. Amen.
Amen.
But I ask myself, for a soldier to go to a battle, why ask him to remove his shoes or his sandals? This is what the Holy Spirit started teaching me 3 weeks ago. Said, you want God to speak to you? You have managed to come to the holy ground, but you are still wearing your shoes. So how can you have physical contact with the holiness? How can you have intimacy with God? How can you touch God? God said to Moses, "Moses, remove your sandals. Joshua, remove your sandals. You have come to my presence, but there is something still between you and I. There's a transparent glass between you and I, and you think you can see me, so that's it. But you have something in your heart that is preventing you from touching me. There is something in your heart. There is a pride. There is self-knowledge. There is self-acclaim, glory that is between you and I. That is preventing us from having intimacy. So remove your sandals." I don't think any of us here will go in bed without your wife or your husband and wearing your jeans trousers. It's not going to happen. God wanted to have intimacy. God wanted to have proper communication. God still wants proper communication with his children.
Amen.
Amen.
But when we are speaking to God and expecting God to speak, I'm expecting God to speak, but I'm expecting that the answer will come through Elder George. That's not how God works. That means I've placed Elder George between me and God. Are you with me?
Amen.
So what are you relying on? What do you depend on? Every military man or every soldier, no matter how heavy his weapon is, if he's not wearing his safety boots, he's not going to battle.
Yeah, you know where the strength is.
Oh, is that so? I call it confidence.
Yeah.
No matter how good you dress, if you are not wearing a good shoe, Though you have dressed all right, but you can see that something is not very right. So I'll tell you something. I always use my wife because I'm comfortable in that zone. I don't want trouble. When we went to lend the money, my wife is not a high heel person. She just opened. Oh, come on, what a beauty.
Man.
Hey. I was by the door. Are you coming out? We're going to leave you here, you know. Come out, as usual. I do it at home everywhere. It happens because she also do it. And she opened the door and I saw her coming and her walking has changed. Oh. By then I was taking pictures. I stopped and I looked at her and I looked at her again. And mommy said to her, pull your dress a little bit and stand this way. And I see the way she turned around. I said, my goodness, I have something. Hallelujah. She's wearing has given her certain confidence, yes, that has brought out, yes, certain confidence, yes, that I thought wasn't there.
Yes. Amen.
The shoe, the sandals God was talking about to Joshua and to Moses is something that gives you confidence. When you stand on some, when I'm wearing a safety boot, I can kick anything. I can kick a stone. I can kick a steel. I can kick anything because I'm wearing a safety boot. But when I'm wearing a slippers,
mind your toes. Mind your toes.
So I realized that God, for God to ask Moses to remove his sandals, he was trying to tell the church, to tell you and I, that anything that gives you false confidence, remove it and rely on him.
Yeah.
Anything that has given you confidence, is it knowledge?
Hey!
Is it your wife? Is it your husband that gives you confidence? Is it your position, education? What is it? Is it money? What is it? Anything that has given you confidence that makes you think, oh yeah, God is, but I know if I have this with me, I'm alright. God said, before I can speak to you, before I can instruct you, before I can download something into your spirit, God, you got to remove that thing.
Amen.
There is a certain degree of pride in everybody. There is a certain degree of faith and knowledge and hope. Let me use hope. Hope in us. That the fact that I'm having a red book in my hand, I can do anything I want. So your hope is the red book. The fact that I've got indefinite. Hey, don't mess with me, you know.
Yeah.
The fact that I have a degree.
There's no point to pray anymore.
That's true.
If poor people are going to church and they are praying and crying, leave them. For me, I'm well to do, I'm okay. But you come to a point in life, mommy, you need God to speak in that situation. You realize that doctors can't help you. Professors can't help you. Philosophers can't find any word to help you. But your help comes from above. And when you realize that your help comes from above, you've got to remove that which is separating you from the holy ground. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In Luke chapter 19, in Luke chapter 19, verse 5. Luke chapter 19, verse 5. Zacchaeus, we all know this guy was short.
Yeah.
And he was a tax collector, so he has made many enemies for himself. But this man happened to hear that Jesus was coming to town. So he decided, I don't have any problem. I have servants who serve me. I'm not seeking my body. But then when I get into my room, I feel miserable because I don't have a friend. So let me just see if I can see this man and something can happen to me. My aim is just to catch a glimpse because I've heard so much about him. So Zacchaeus, we all know, he went to climb a tree.
A physical challenge.
Brother, it doesn't matter what is confronting you. That must not separate you from God.
No.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Zacchaeus climbed the tree. Jesus got to the spot. Zacchaeus didn't see him first, he saw him first. And said, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down. For today, I will dwell in your house. His expectation was to see Christ. But Christ got there and he said, come down, I will stay in your house. I will not only let you see me, I will dine with you, I will sleep with you, I will communicate with you, I will have chat with you. Brother, sister, my point here is that
deliverance is coming to you.
God is speaking salvation, deliverance, healing, everything. But we have lifted ourselves so high, thinking that is where we can reach God. But Jesus said, I can't come on the tree with you. I can't stay with you. If I have to stay with you, I can't. We can't dine on the tree. You've got to come down. Tell somebody, come down. Come down from your pride. Come down, come down. Whatever has lifted your shoulders, bring it down so that Jesus can dwell with you. Please, come down.
Yes, come down.
Come down.
Come down.
Amen.
Come down.
What you have packed is not for you. It's not what is going to bring God. But if you really want to hear God, you've got to move from that position. You've got to remove something, shift something, separate yourselves from something. In fact, the shoe of Moses and the shoe of Joshua, I've combined these two passages because they talk about the same thing. And the vision is that this shoe gave them certain comfort. Imagine you are walking on a desert barefoot. It's not comfortable, but with the shoe, it gave them comfort, and they relied so much on their shoe. Remove your comfort zone. Come out from your comfort zone so I can touch you, so I can kiss you. Come out from your comfort zone so that I can break something through you. Come out from your comfort zone so that I can show the world that I am still God. Come out. My comfort zone this week was that I was going to gather my literature. I was going to study. I was going to wait on the Lord. And when I get a message, I will investigate. I will write. I will write my notes. I will find references and everything, and then preach. But God said, move from your comfort zone. As of this morning, I was so worried. Not knowing the message is actually speaking to myself. That this is your comfort zone. I'm teaching you something. I am the Lord. I do what I want to do.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Not until you move or you agree to move from your comfort zone, to separate yourself from your comfort zone, nothing is going to happen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's quickly look at John as well. John 11, verse 39, Jesus said something quickly. He said, remove the stone. This is when Jesus has come to the scene of the tomb of Lazarus. I like that passage. Every time I read it, I learn something different from there.
Man.
You see, Jesus came to the tomb, after he reported everything to him, and they told him, this guy is dead so many days, and it's stinking now. So, what do you intend to do? He got to the tomb, and he said, remove the stone. Remove the stone. Church, what I learned here is that before God can speak to somebody, to your dead situation, somebody must be willing to remove the stone. If the stone is still there, he can speak all he wants, but the dead situation will not hear anything. But God wants you to move your faith by removing the stone. The stone was there to prevent the smell coming out. The stone was there to prevent Lazarus coming out. Even if Lazarus had come out, He couldn't come out of the tomb. Because the stone was there. This morning, a brief message is that remove that which is separating you from the holy ground. For you have come to the holy ground. The message is that remove the stone, the stumbling block, the reason why you cannot hear God. You have to identify it. There are certain things God will not do it for you that. For all you know, he has given us our own will. He has given us our will. If you have to fast, he will give you the prompt, as we are learning in Bible studies. He'll give you the prompt in your spirit. If you listen and you refuse to fast, God will not force it on you. But God wants you to remove the stone. Talking about this, the liberation and the salvation of the Israelites was hanging. And some people are suffering. So I'm here to tell you today that your disobedience will cause somebody to continue to suffer. Because God wants to save someone through you. Imagine Moses had refused that this is a desert.
Yeah, it's
too hot and it's a mountain. Mm. And there are snakes, scorpions. So if I remove my sandals,
you don't know what you can fight. Mm.
God can speak all right, but God cannot give you the instruction he has to give you. This morning I've come to tell you that anything that is separating you from your holy ground, anything that is broken your communication with God, remove it. Because God is willing to speak to you. God is willing to talk to you individually. It's not only the pastor, it's not only prophet, but God wants to speak to you as a son, as a daughter, as a child of God. God wants to have communication with you. But your eye is on somebody else. Your faith and your hope is in something else. This morning, remove your shoes. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Remove your shoes and God will speak to you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 The Bible says in Mark 10 verse 25, it says it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Mm. Not because riches are not good, but sometimes because of one's riches and one's position and one's faith level, he see God differently on a different, and we can't dedicate ourselves to the Lord. We're going to pray, but I'm not going to lead the prayers. I will leave mommy to comment on this and then pray with us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. What I want to say and what I have said is that just remove the sandals. God was telling Moses, remove your sandals because you are in the holy ground. You have come to a place where God wants to have relationship with you. So remove that which is separating you from God. God bless you. Amen.